Six out of ten Republicans recommend FTR Radio to everyone they know. The other four are rhinos. FTR Radio. Online at FTRradio.com. FTR Radio salutes some of the great Democrat presidents in the radio era. FTR Radio.
You're listening to Liz and Taylor.
All right, so why can't I get another tattoo? Come on.
Because you get another tattoo, then you start talking another gun.
But not the movie star. The battling duo from the right war on FTR Radio.
Oh, come on.
You're the one who said it.
That was a joke, partially.
Enlist in the right war. Won't cost you nothing. Not as good as military service. But it's got to count for something, right?
Good evening, folks. Thank you for listening to FTR Radio. I'm Liz Harrison. This is The Right War. And, of course, I still have Taylor here. Everybody can go into heart failure now. We might have stapled him to the ground or something. But even more importantly,
no
be
longer
terrified.
Painting, just no longer staple. Or I'm sorry, no longer chaining to the wall, stapling to the ground.
Yes. And we managed to wrangle Jason. So you know, I'm gonna chain myself to the wall again. Because I'm already in trouble as far as Jason's concerned.
Damn right you are.
If anybody did not see, oh dear, I guess I've got to like pull it or something. the charming little photo.
See, Liz is impressed that I can dress up from time to time.
No, and the whole world is impressed you can dress up from time to time.
No, I actually, I was
Let's
remarking.
Let's be honest.
So last Friday, I had to speak at Americans for Tax Reform. They had an event in their headquarters, and I was invited to speak, and we were talking about civil asset forfeiture. And I was on a panel. It was called Civil Asset Forfeiture Undue Process. And because of it was a serious event, I was on a panel with Grover Norquist, who's the president of ATR, and Walter Olson, who's a senior fellow at Cato. I decided that it would be appropriate to wear a suit. And on the way in, I saw Chris Butler, who's Grover's chief of staff at ATR, and I remarked to him that this was only the third time in my adult life that I have worn a suit. And he was just looking at me like, you've got to be kidding me. And I said, no, I'm dead serious. This is the third time in my entire adult life I have worn a suit. And I actually posted on Instagram not too long ago the first time in my adult life I had worn a suit. That was my mother's. When she got remarried, I was 22 years old, and I was 21 years old, and I was a best man, and yeah, so I don't really like suits. I don't like dressing up. I think the whole thing is kind of silly, but that's just me. I prefer casual because for me, nothing is sacred. I just posted a link to Instagram of the first time I wore a suit in my adult life. So yeah, good times. That, yeah. The picture
you
list.
And the short, wow.
Yeah.
Holy crap.
I look like I would kick your ass, right?
No, you, oh. Well, okay, you do look like Venkman, so yeah.
It wasn't a happy day. I remember having a lot of mixed emotions that day, so. The picture that Liz posted was actually
I'd still probably win the fight.
The picture Liz posted in the chat room is in March. I had to go to the White House and the Justice Department, and that's the suit I wore. Actually, that's the only suit I currently own, and I've been told I should probably buy another one as well as a new tie. But I don't really.
Yes,
care.
You have to wrangle Larry O'Connor.
Larry's
to go tie shopping.
He's a snappy dresser.
Exactly. You have to, but don't do the gingham shirts. I always yell at him for that. I can't stand men in gingham.
I was thinking about going to Benny and Johnson and see if he could go one day when I'm in DC to go shopping somewhere.
Jason, we're coming.
We're Yeah, we're breaking up on you.
Yeah,
so.
Jason, we're going to call you.
Yeah. Bye-bye, Jason.
Fix your mic.
It's so much fun. We get to hear ring, ring, ring now. Mm-hmm. Maybe. There it goes. See? Open source tech or something.
All right. Is that better?
Fix your microphone.
Huh?
Fix your microphone.
My microphone's fine, dude.
Okay.
Or when was the last time you rebooted your computer?
I don't know, 2-3 weeks ago.
Okay, well, then, that might be it. Reboot your computer.
Yeah. Yeah, okay, well, exactly.
I'm on my cell phone right now, so.
Yeah.
Yes, I know. Yeah, we
just called you on it.
All right.
We're having one of these days. I'm just...
You guys are a-holes.
Anyway, I've just been raising hell today. I'm just a troublemaker. It all started earlier about making new laws and.
Oh, can I give a leftist props for being consistent?
Yeah. You were impressed with a feminist today.
I was impressed. I was very impressed. Now, I think she's wrong. But I was very impressed.
What, the whole tattoo thing?
The whole, what was it, tat calling, that's what they call it? Yeah, tat calling.
Yeah, tat calling.
The whole tat calling thing, yeah.
I'm lost. What happened here?
All right. So, earlier today, there was an article that was posted over at maybe a couple of days ago, there was an article that was posted at Modern Feminist or something like that, which said, and Kat Timp over at National Review picked this up, but there was an article posted at Everyday Feminism called "Please Stop Tat Calling Me."
Do people still catcall? Is that still a thing?
No. Tat. Tat call. T-A-T.
Oh. Oh. What?
Okay. So here's what Melissa Fabello was saying. And Melissa, if you're listening, hi. Welcome to FTR Radio. Not that I think you are.
Nah.
So Melissa Fabello says, this is how she starts off her piece. I'm standing in line at an airport Starbucks, shifting my weight back and forth as I try to leverage the bulk of my backpack stuffed with too many outfit choices for a weekend trip, peering over the counter to see if they have any packets of Earl Grey tea left. I feel a tap on my shoulder, so I turn around. A man who I do not know is crouching and gawking at me. Can you turn a little this way, he asks. I'm trying to look at your legs. Because what he's trying to do is he's trying to look at the tattoos that she has on her legs. And so she was talking. So she later says that she was talking to that a clever friend named Kathy came up with the idea of tat calling, which is what they said it was. And what she says was, while she was out, just to prove a point about what a day in the life of a tattooed woman out in public in a patriarchal society feels like. The total came to 10 times in 40 minutes. 10 times a strange man shouted to me, nice tats, or I love your tattoos, or where do you get your work done? One guy even literally stopped to show me his tattoo. And while I responded genuinely thank you to each and every one of them, and although it started to become comical after a while, the truth is, when you think about it, that's really not okay.
This is the stupidest thing I've ever heard in my entire life.
I happen to agree. But I tweeted her. I tweeted her.
I'm actually tempted to get my wife in here. she's awake right now, and because she has like 20 tattoos.
I'd be and down with that. Liz, would you be down with that?
Sure.
Okay.
Let me go hunt her down, because I just want her like 2 cents on this. Hold on, let me go find her real fast. Keep going, Taylor.
Okay. So, what I said to... I tweeted Melissa very nicely, I thought. Very, very, very nicely, I thought, saying, legit question, I've had girls ask to see my tattoos and pull my shirt up to see without permission. Is that tat calling or no? To be fair, it's happened only once. And actually, Jason Pye was there. But I don't know if he's listening. And this is what Melissa Fabello said. And again, I give her credit for this because she's being very consistent here. I think that's super objectifying. Yeah, I mean, it's also about consent, though. If you were cool with it, then cool. But I would argue they shouldn't have assumed. That's the real issue, presumption. And I said to her,
No, go ahead.
Okay. And I replied to her, yeah, and I appreciate the reason and consistent response. Because if she had said, oh, I have, you know, if she hadn't responded or just been like, you know, don't be a jerk, then, you know, I would have had a problem with it. But she was consistent at this, and so I give her credit for being consistent, even though I think she's wrong.
Miss Pye shan't be joining us. She's like, I don't know what to say. The reason I wanted her to come in here is because we're out together a lot, and she gets stopped constantly, especially when we're at a music festival or we're going out just in downtown Atlanta to go have lunch or dinner or whatever we're doing. And she, a lot of times she'll wear shorts. She has tattoos on her chest. And sometimes when she wears a low-cut shirt, you can see her tattoos. And when she wears short-sleeved shirts, you can see the tattoos she has on her arms. And we constantly get stopped, and she never complains about this. Like, I mean, if you have tattoos, like, I'm not saying it's a source, like, you get attention for having tattoos, but even as a guy, I don't have as many tattoos as my wife has, but I have 2 very visible tattoos when I'm wearing a short-sleeved shirt. And I'd sometimes, especially if the person's a libertarian and they notice what the tattoos are, they'll stop me and ask me about them, and they'll talk about them, or I get compliments about them. I think this person just wants something. They want something to complain about. That's it.
Well, if I think that like someone's tattoos are really, really cool looking, and are like, you know, totally worth commenting on, I'll comment on it. If I see, you know, someone with, you know, I saw someone who I thought had Sanskrit from, like, they got it from a window or something like that. It looked great. And so I complimented them. I was like, I seriously asked, like, where'd you get the design for? Where did you find it? You know, I was just curious.
Yeah. I mean, I don't stop people to talk about tattoos because I have my own, but and I just, you know, I know how much they cost. I know what, you know, because I'm reading some of the comments she leaves here, and it's just I don't know, man. It's just like, this is just someone wanting attention, in my opinion. Like, this is, I want something to complain about. This is me wanting attention, so I'm going to complain about getting ass on my tattoos. That's what it sounds like to me. I just don't.
If you don't want asked about your tattoos, then you don't get them in places where, you know.
No, exactly. I mean, if you don't want to get stopped about tattoos, don't get visible tattoos. If you think it's an inconvenience, don't have them. Because although we live in a society that's more that has attitudes have changed toward tattoos, and like even employers, it used to be employers didn't like people who had tattoos, but they're now becoming more commonplace in the workplace, so people don't complain about them as much. They are becoming more acceptable. People still want to ask questions because you may see someone who, you know, the person who may be asking, you may be thinking about getting a tattoo. That's happened to me a number of times where, well, I, you know, does it hurt bad? I mean, does it, you know, they don't usually ask about the cost, but, you know, I mean, my wife has them on tops of her feet, that's like one of the biggest questions she gets. Well, did that hurt? You know, what are they? You know, I mean, can you explain the meaning of this? Like, these are kind of common questions that people get who have tattoos. I don't understand. This is just the dumbest thing I've ever heard. I can't emphasize that enough. This is just the dumbest thing I've ever heard.
Yeah.
I'm perplexed by it. I really am. I don't understand it.
Oh, it's ridiculous. I mean, it creeps me out a little bit when people want to see mine, but that means that, like, somebody will grab me by my left hand and, like, turn my wrist and, you know, maybe move my watch. So, yeah, that sort of gets creepy.
Yeah, I can imagine that. I mean, like, obviously, there's a difference between good touch and bad touch. But just kind of, I'm blown away by this. I really am. I don't understand it. I just don't get tattoos. You don't want to be inconvenienced. Don't get tattoos. I mean, it's the same. Yeah. It's like the same thing. I mean, you see people because on the streets in DC or in airports, I see people with piercings. I see people with tattoos. And honestly, I don't pay them much attention, but I do see them. I mean, I'm sure they get stopped too, and it's guys and girls. Guys get these questions too.
Oh yeah.
Hey, remember when my shirt got pulled up at the bar?
Oh yeah. No, exactly. Yeah. Of course, everybody there was drunk.
Everybody but me. But yeah.
Taylor was never drunk.
I wasn't.
Okay.
Well, I can't say
everybody
that.
But you and me.
Yeah. I started buying people drinks because I was having good conversations.
Yeah. It was a fun time. But yeah, I mean, it's like, but yeah, it's, you know, I will give, you know, the author, you know, I'll give her props for being consistent, even if I disagree with her and think she's just flat out wrong. But hey, at least she's consistent. If you're going to be for something, be freaking consistent.
Yeah, I agree with that. Liz, looks like you tried. Liz, let me ask you a question. I see your tattoo in the chat room. Did you try to get something covered up?
Yeah, that was a triskel. And now the two tattoos have faded. Like, the second tattoo has faded. So it's the triskel is no longer really visible underneath. It's, like, nowhere near like that one is. That was right after I was inked, so.
Ah, yeah, I can tell.
Yeah, he had just, yeah, you could see the pink and the ink that he hadn't completely cleaned off my arm.
Yeah, yet. Right. Speaking of tattoos, I really need another one.
Yeah, same here. I'm going through the, I'm going to look at art, and then I'm going to go and talk to Hyla or Michael, and then whatever I had in mind is going to go flying right out the window.
I can't get any more tattoos.
Why?
Why?
Because I have to catch up on guns.
Oh.
Oh.
How many behind are you?
Two.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, that's a problem. You have two guns, or you're two behind?
I'm two behind.
Oh.
I have three guns. I need two more. Because I have five tattoos.
Oh, gotcha. I see. I have one gun. But that's all I need.
Yeah.
They were asking
what was on my arm. It was a triskel.
You trolled. Why did you troll Melissa Fabello, Liz?
Because I'm being mean. And I wanted, you know what? I learned something a long time ago. If you go and talk about any of these people, and then they find out from some bizarre reason, and you didn't let them know, then they throw fits. So now we can't have anybody throwing any fits. She can look and see. She can ask. We didn't say anything mean about her.
No, we didn't. In fact, we praised her for being consistent. Although, it was amusing when, because we had Matt Lewis on last week on Politinerds Radio. over at the Evil Vigilant Liberty Radio. And he, or no, I'm sorry, 2 weeks ago. And he was talking about his, the fact that he was on Real Time with Bill Maher and how Bill Maher was, you know, essentially a jerk to him. And I freaking tagged Bill Maher on the post.
Oh, dear. And people are asking on the Twitter if I'm drunk. I opened one bottle of beer, okay, folks? And
for now.
I haven't even made it through halfway yet.
Just one?
Just one. Yeah.
All night long, just one. That's all you've had.
I didn't start drinking until I filed a story at United Liberty. Because that was the last thing I wrote for the night. And, you know, I have these rules. I had done an article, like I mentioned Michael and Hyla, did an article on tattoos, ironically enough. So, basically, it's...
You only asked if Liz was drunk because you retweeted my preview.
I guess.
Well,
I have no idea.
That's not why. I was just being silly.
Mm. OGD says I'm leaving 98 bottles still on the wall or something.
Right. Only because he can,
I don't have that many.
Only because he can outdrink me.
Anybody could outdrink me. I think Taylor could outdrink me. That's how sad it's gotten, folks.
I don't know.
I've missed you guys.
I know. I know. You have been away for so long. It feels like forever.
Yeah, hopefully 3 straight weeks at home. So then hopefully that means three straight shows.
That works for me.
So, yeah.
We thought you were never coming back, Jason.
We thought you were being kidnapped.
Taylor's like that dog after the owner leaves. You just sit in front of the door the entire time.
More like a cat, actually. But
whatever.
I'll climb into your
suitcase. Yeah, he's a cat person.
I'll climb into your suitcase and lay down in it. You're never leaving again. You're never leaving again. Ever.
We've all... Wait, what cat?
I have cats. The cats get mad when I'm not here because I work from home 90% of the time. I feed them during the day and stuff, but when I'm not here, my wife's at work, so they only get food in the morning, and they don't get anything else until like 6:15 in the afternoon or in the evening, and they're like, yeah, it's like they don't like it when I'm not home, so it is how I don't know if they notice. So
whenever I go on vacation, like if I go somewhere, which isn't that often, but you know, when I go somewhere, I have had Ava, if my suitcase is open and Ava sees that the suitcase is open, she will get in the suitcase.
Our cats do that too, yeah.
It's like, yeah. Where are you going? Are you taking me with you? Don't take me with you.
Right. They also get my open. Oh my god.
Green Death, you are mean. Pi is only 20 years in a gender reassignment surgery away from being an old crazy cat lady. Wow.
I can't drop F bombs on the air. Thank you.
Let's see. Let's see.
Liz, can you cover this for me?
Go fuck yourself, Green Death.
Thank you, Taylor. We were both sitting there like, I can't do it either.
Why can't
Taylor is
do
the
it?
Only one with freedom.
Wait, why can't you do it?
I had words with somebody.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
I can put it in the chat room.
Doc Robbins, crack down on you?
In not him, yeah, a little bit higher up the feeding chain. Yeah, there, that works.
Nobody's saying anything about the fact that I actually swore on air?
Yes, you actually swore on air. But that has happened before, or else I'd be saying something about popping cherries.
Anyway. Yes, it's very rare that I...
Are we really not using phrasing anymore?
Phrasing!
Hey, I think that one's fair. I mean, really, come on now. We're all adults here.
I watched a lot of Archer over the past like week or two, and like all I can think of are stupid things that are said on Archer, including phrasing. So anything that has an end of the sexual connotation, yeah.
It's either phrasing or danger zone.
Yes.
Yeah, Liz, you better be careful because you're living in the danger zone.
Especially on Friday nights.
I finally got keyed in to Archer.
Oh, good God. It took this long?
Yeah.
See, I'm saying this, and I have only watched maybe two or three episodes, so...
Did you watch it at my recommendation, or did you do it just because you're in tune with what the kids are watching these days?
Both you and Sean Venkman.
Yeah, okay. Mr. Faux Pas, because, you know, he isn't really Archer. So... Oh dear God, Jenny, I wish that were true. She's saying if Schlichter can talk about Raymond Burr's chocolate love box,
right? Well, we have a break though, so
yeah, we do. But yeah, we there are those of us that are not as free as Schlichter.
True.
It sucks.
Schlichter is his own boss.
Yeah, Schlichter is his own boss. Some of us actually have to, you know, deal with the man or something.
Yeah, man just keeps us down, man.
The man just keeps us down. Well, anyway, as promised, we do have Pint-Sized Pundit coming up. You will hear him do Taylor's disclaimer first, and then he will be talking. And I'm sorry, it's not politics, but at least it is baseball. So... I have a sneaking suspicion this one will be one that Duke might not like because the Pirates just swept the team in Detroit.
Yeah, except for that he said that he liked the team in Detroit, though. So is he really going to be that mean?
I don't know. I really don't. It's one of those things. So, anyway, we'll be right back. Hello, this is Liz Harrison from The Right War here on FTR Radio, and when I want to bring you the best conservative talk on the net, I use Radio Boss from DJsoft.net.
This is the Pint-Sized Pundit, and I'm here to tell you that anything Taylor says on The Right War is his opinion and his opinion only. He does not speak for his employees, his employer's employer, or anyone else. He especially does not speak for my mom unless she says so.
And now, it's time for the Pint-Sized Pundit. Politics, sports, and everything else under the sun.
Hello, everybody. So, I kind of have a small headache today, but I'm trying to get it in. A little segment in. I like to talk about sports. I'm trying to get primarily on sports now because of, you know, that's my thing that I know about. So I'm gonna be the sports person I wanna be at this station or whatever. I get confused. Anyway, in the MLB, the Pirates sweeping Detroit I'm not going to hit on Detroit. I like Detroit. I like J.D. Martinez. I like Rajah Davis. I hate Verlander, though. I think he deserved that loss. I don't think it should have gone into 14 innings. I think it should have gone into 9. And, you know, Verlander 0-2. I hate him. He doesn't have the skills that he had in 2011. Let me think. Who else is there? Did I say J.D. Martinez? Yeah. Miguel Cabrera. Ian Kinsler. But other than that, Pirates sweep Detroit. The Pirates lead the MLB, as of now, in sweeps with 9 sweeps. And this is Detroit's second time being swept. Now, let me tell you something about what happened with Pittsburgh and Detroit this year. Detroit comes out of Pittsburgh for their home opening series, leading, like, the games 2-1. Like, they won 2, Pittsburgh won 1. Now they're all done for the year, and Pittsburgh wins the series 4-2. That shows you that they're getting better. Also, let me think. What else is going on? Astros, they're shocking me this year. I mean, yeah, their pitching is really getting good. And with Jason Castro, I like him behind the plate better than Stewart as our secondary catcher. I'll have to talk about catchers in Pittsburgh. We like New York when it comes to catchers. The Pirates love the Yankees for catchers. We got Russell Martin from the Yankees before, you know, when we signed him, when we traded for him. We got Chris Stewart the year after that from the Yankees. We got Francisco Cervelli this year from the Yankees. Are you seeing a pattern? And also, Cervelli, he is a lot better than he ever was with New York. You Yankees fans and Cervelli fans, if you are even out there, I don't think they exist because of not really many people cared for Cervelli. He sucked. He sucked. End of discussion. At least compared to what he's doing with Pittsburgh. He's 3rd in the National League in voting for All-Star Game. Probably the best hitting catcher that the Pirates have had since Russell Martin in 2013. And that's saying something, because he might not have the power of Martin in 2013, but he has the better contact, in my opinion. If there's anybody you want at bat with a man on 3rd and 1 out or no outs, it's him, because he'll hit it anywhere that you want it. You want it in the outfield, he'll hit it, even if it's an out. He'll hit it in the opposite direction away from 3rd base, so he could get to home. So, yeah. That's all I'd like to say today. I'm a big Pirates fan. Sorry if I don't get all of your teams. I have to get updated with some of them on ESPN or whatever I decide to update. So, goodbye. Happy summer. Happy 4th of July. Bye. I'm waving to you if you can't see.
It doesn't matter who we are. What matters is our plan. You should have respected my authority.
Hi, this is Charles C.W. Cook, and you're listening to FTR Radio.
Bust out the windows, put his family on food stamps now. He's a big spender, no food on the table, and the bills ain't paid, 'cause he spent it on cigarettes and PGA. They'll turn us all into beggars, cause they're easier to please. They're feeding our people that government cheese.
And we're back. Outtakes, folks, I'm telling you. It's a trip.
That's what happens when we start discussing, you know, well, we were discussing gay marriage.
Well, you two were discussing it. I was sitting here,
you were discussing
eating,
it too.
Sort of. Well, I was sort of kind of eating, too, because, you know, break. And it didn't really, see, now Taylor's going to yell at me because I didn't really have dinner.
Really?
Oh,
really?
Why not?
I started eating dinner, and then I didn't finish, so I was just finishing some of it.
Okay.
I'm pulling out my low-carb brownie.
Yeah, the eldest offspring brought home breaded zucchini. So,
ooh.
Yeah.
Oh, something else I did, I actually did troll, totally trolled someone today. I was in a trolley mood today.
So, that's you every day?
No, I was feeling specifically trolley today. I'm not going to link to the piece because I don't want to give the fact that I have to look it up, meaning that they give clickbait, but I'll say it anyway. You know, I like... Well, you and I both like Dara over at Vox.
Yeah.
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 She's too smart to work there.
Vox has some good writers. Like, Timothy Lee's a good writer.
Well, all right. Here's why I say that. We're talking Dara Lind, who's involved in criminal justice reform over at Vox. Today, and yes, I know that they were totally being trolly and whatever. Today, Dylan Matthews wrote 3 reasons the American Revolution was a mistake.
What?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, I gotta go read this.
Fine, I'll link it to it in... I'll link it in the Skype chat. Here, I just linked it in the Skype chat, Jason.
Thank you.
But you'll love this, okay? The main reason the revolution was a mistake, I'm quoting here, okay? The main reason the revolution was a mistake is that the British Empire, in all likelihood, would have abolished slavery earlier than the U.S. did, and with less bloodshed. Abolition in most of the British Empire occurred in 1834 following the passage of the Slavery Abolition Act that left out India, but slavery was banned there too in 1843. In England itself, slavery was illegal, at least going back to 1772. That's decades earlier than the United States. So, let me... I want to read something.
It's making my ears bleed.
No. Hang on. Let me read all something right, because this is important. And let me. All right. Although Patrick Henry sought to ban the importation of slaves, the Assembly agreed only to slow the influx of slaves with a tax that would make importation more costly but not prohibited. Virginia had actually voted to ban slavery early in the century, but the government of Good Queen Anne overruled the act because of the Royal Treasury's dependence on revenues from British slave traders. That... is from Lion of Liberty, on a book on Patrick Henry, by Harlow Unger, which everybody should read. Okay. And yes, it does talk about him trying to make Christianity the official religion of Virginia, and how that backfired on him.
Yeah, no, it did. I like, I've gotten a little out of my early American history. Like, I haven't, like, done a lot of reading on it in a long time, but, like, the colonies, well, I think in 1776, Massachusetts was the first American colony to eradicate slavery, to ban slavery, and then other ones followed suit. I think all the northern colonies by, I want to say, like, the early 1800s had eliminated slavery. Something like that, right, Taylor?
The northern
colonies.
Not 100%. There were still slaves in northern states, though.
Okay. All right, well, they were colonies when they started out. They were states. They became states. But yeah. You know what I mean. I'm trying to think of, weren't there other countries that were under British control that still had slaves until, like, the early 1800s or mid-1800s? I want to say there were. I don't know. It just seems, are we going to get a debate on the Confederate flag? Is that where this is going?
No, I wasn't planning on getting into a debate. Although, I am curious about your thoughts on it.
I just need to make sure Green Death isn't going to come over to my house and kill me.
Green Death would never hurt you.
The only good Confederate flag is a burned Confederate flag.
No. No.
Yeah.
No, you know why? And I said it earlier on the air today. I mean, I don't have a problem with all of the people who go and reenact it. And honestly, I'm not even sure I have, like, the battles. Because, you know what? No matter how many times they reenact it, they still lose. But... but
yeah, it's not like that episode of Family Guy.
But right. You know, I really do appreciate the ability to be able to filter out the Neanderthals, so to speak, the redneck boys who I want nothing to do with. As long as they're out there and have that flag, I know what I'm dealing with. That's a good thing.
Here is my question, though. The Confederate flag argument, you know, if it's in a historical standpoint, like Six Flags Over Texas.
Well, are you going to give me the benefit of the doubt here with the people who we have here who are sons and daughters of the Confederacy? You know, they're showing that their ancestors had been, you know, Confederates.
Could I
Yes, go on. Okay. Go on.
I don't mind, you know, when it comes to taking down the Confederate flag at, like, South Carolina, you know, the whatever. You know, they have every right to do that. What I don't like is the whitewashing of history that it's now become. You know, where it's like, okay, you know, you've got to, you know, we can't have schools named after Robert E. Lee, or we can't have schools named after, you know, other people who may have connotations or involvement outside of their role in the Confederate, in the Confederacy, you know, completely whitewashing them from history. I have a big problem with it, because I think the reason why there hasn't been another rebellion. And, you know, people have talked about secession before. I'm not saying this from a, you know, oh, Texas ought to just secede from the Union. I'm talking, you know, people who try to be, you know, serious about we need to secede. And the reason why that stuff doesn't get much traction is because people remember how destructive the Civil War was.
Right.
Well,
yeah.
The whitewashing of history, that's what bugs me. You know, the other thing is that, go ahead, Jason. Sorry.
No. Go ahead. Finish your thought, please. Do.
Okay. The other thing to remember, and listen, whether I agree with it or not, you know, the use of the Confederate flag in, I think, a lot of instances, the battle flag in particular, because this is what a lot of the debate is about, is that it's become an issue of Southern pride. Now, why has it become an issue of Southern pride? Well, you know, I think a part of it had to do with how Reconstruction was done and how, you know, equally destructive Reconstruction was. And the fact, you know, it wasn't the Civil War ended, Lincoln got assassinated, and everything went back to normal. It was the Civil War ended, Lincoln got, you know, got assassinated, and then the Republicans, let's be honest here, the Northern Republicans came down to the South and basically said, okay, we're getting our pound of flesh. We won, we're getting our pound of flesh. It's the same thing that happened in World War One with the Allied powers versus what happened with Germany and what happened there.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. I mean, and I think a lot of people, I think some of the critiques of Lincoln and Sherman because of Sherman's March to the Sea in Georgia, I mean, I grew up in Clayton County, which is where Jonesboro, Georgia is located, Jonesboro, Georgia being the setting of Gone with the Wind. I was actually born when I was first born, we lived in Jonesboro. But I think the critiques of Lincoln being, some people call him a tyrant, I would not go that far, but I would say he did abuse his power in suspending habeas corpus without approval from Congress when the Constitution explicitly says that you have to get approval from Congress to suspend habeas corpus. That's an example. Imprisoning people for speaking out against his administration is another example. And there are other examples I can cite. But with all that said, it's like, before I go on, I want to give some background on my viewpoint on this. Is, you know, I was a teenager in high school. I was in high school when the debate over the Confederate battle flag being on the Georgia flag was raging. And at the time, I was in the punk rock scene and listening to a lot of punk rock and racial equality was a big thing in the scene. And there was a band at the time, Taylor, you may have heard of them, they're called Squad 5-0.
They're called what?
Song, Squad 5-0.
Yeah, the name sounds familiar.
Yeah, they're from Savannah, Georgia. They were a Christian punk rock band, and one of their songs was "Our State Flag Sucks." And it was about the debate on the flag in like 1997 or 1998. And the song was clearly directed at Governor Roy Barnes, who was scared to death that changing the flag would cost him his bid for re-election in 2002. So that's kind of like, I grew up in that scene. I've always been sensitive to racial issues. My family, I mean, I'm the seventh generation Georgian. My family has been here since I believe, late 18th century. Or early 19th century, nevertheless. But, you know, I had a great, 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 whatever many great grandfathers served, in the Confederate Army, my ancestors owned slaves. So I'm aware of all this stuff, and I'm not saying what I believe because of that stuff. I'm saying because we shouldn't whitewash history. Absolutely not. And I think some of the stuff that has gone on is overkill and just kind of they've pushed it too far in a lot of ways, because we should remember this. Like, trying to have – there's a business here in Georgia. The former chairman of the Democratic Party of Georgia is trying to force the business to remove their Confederate flag out of the restaurant. That's private business. They can do what they want to, let the market sort it out, sort of thing. But on the state house in South Carolina, in Columbia, that's a problem, because that state house represents all the people, not just, you know what I mean? Like, that should come down.
Well, and you look at the, the reason why, if this is correct, you know, John Sammons Bell was the one who designed the 1956 Georgia flag. And, you know, he was apparently, what, like a big segregationist and stuff like that?
Most Georgians were at the time. Okay. So, yeah. I mean, I think we had some people who believed, we had governors or at least politicians who believed in segregation until like the late 60s, at least publicly, or maybe even early 70s. But it's, I don't know, I mean, I would personally, I would never own an article of clothing or would never personally own a Confederate flag. I think one of the most, and like I said earlier that the only good Confederate flag is a burned Confederate flag. I would never go out of my way to burn someone else's property or anything like that. But if I ever had one, if I ever had one land on my front door, that's what I would do to it.
Okay, do we know what Brad Avakian did? Liz?
No.
Okay.
He's basically one of those Fruit Loops. He's a labor muckety muck up in Oregon, and okay. Apparently he's been talking gay pride and wage equity and
compulsory leave. Here's why it is. He was the one who, Avakian is the one who finalized a preliminary ruling today ordering Aaron and Melissa Klein to pay $135,000 in emotional damages to the lesbian couple they denied services to. That's who he is.
Okay, that's what it is. Yeah. So it's
okay,
gay
anyway,
marriage.
Sorry to switch topics there.
No worries. I was pretty much done anyway, except to say that Amazon and eBay and all these other online vendors who are taking down the Confederate flag, this is one valid criticism, but are still continuing to sell merchandise with the images of communist figures like Che Guevara or Joseph Stalin or Mao Zedong.
Or Nazi stuff.
That's extreme hypocrisy on their part.
Yeah.
If you're going to do it for one, you have to do it for all.
They have every right to do it, but they are being hypocritical.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. But that's just me. That's just my opinion. I'm a terrible Southerner. So.
Whatever. My basic problem is that you go and start editing your history. Number one, you end up being doomed to repeat it. Look at Germany.
Sure.
And number two, we're only half a step away from what the Soviets were doing. And actually, not even really that far. It's dangerously close. I mean, when the Soviets didn't like somebody, they erased them from history. Leftists today don't like something. They shame people to the point where you just cannot talk about it anymore, which is effectively erasing history.
Sure. No, I mean, I get that. And I think that's an important distinction, like, I really do. And I'm not saying we should try to erase history. I'm not saying we should try to forget history, because those who forget history are doomed to repeat it. That's the old adage, right? But,
right.
I mean, I think that we do have to be mindful. And there was a really great article this week Washington Post about how this debate wouldn't be so bad if there weren't so many people trying to revise history. I mean, the big line I hear from most people is like, well, the Civil War wasn't fought over slavery, it was fought over states' rights. So, come on. Read the secession documents and get back to me. Because if you read the secession documents, it's adamantly clear that they were trying to protect slavery. Read the Cornerstone speech by Alexander Stevens. The Cornerstone speech is all about slavery. You can't whitewash that stuff.
No, you can't, but you also can't whitewash the other half of the story.
No, you're right. You can't.
Which is that the vast majority of the South, even the ones that were affluent, could not continue to exist the way they had been, could not do business the way they were, with all of the taxation, tariffs, and other things that were going on from the North. Now, arguably, the North was theoretically, see, this is whitewashing history, trying to force them to give up slavery by punishing them financially, but that's putting the cart before the horse. The abolition movement in the North didn't start when the taxation did. It was a matter of the North wanting to keep a firm grip on the South, and that was the way to do it. Which one is evil? I mean, they both were, and when all the chips fell, where was racism worse?
Okay.
In the North.
I don't agree with that at all. I mean, we were talking about states that had abolished slavery compared to states that actually, where these people considered slaves to be property, people to be property. You look at the secession documents, I mean, I can't remember which one it was specifically, but I think it may have been Texas that specifically spoke of the inferiority of the slave to the white man. I mean, yeah. That's
well, yet again, Jason, we're running out of time.
Now. You know, one thing we can do, we can cut the FTR stream and keep going on VLR.
Ha ha. No, I can't do that.
Okay.
Only could do that if Tom went and did it.
Gotcha.
I could go and re-pick up the stream.
Gotcha. Okay.
So... yeah, it's about that time, folks. So thank you very much for listening. You can catch Taylor at TaylorMVLR on the Twitter, and of course Jason at Jace Liberty. Unless, of course, he's at my throat, then you know where to find him. And of course, I'm at Goldwater Gal, and somehow I'm going to make it through tomorrow after the really interesting day today. Have a great night, folks. Say goodnight, guys.
Good night, guys.
Yeah, Jason's not talking to us anymore. Good night, folks.
Good night. Sorry.